Well, hello and welcome to the Michael Jackson History Special. I'll tell you what, look, it's been the absolute most manic week I can ever remember in my life. It started around about Wednesday when we flew to Sydney. When Michael arrived in Sydney, the fans became hysterical. Well, by Thursday, the media had become hysterical as well. In fact, I've never seen anything like it. There was just so much coverage of Michael Jackson, not only about the concert, but also him being there in Sydney, but also all the things that happened. I've never seen media go so crazy. The international media flew in, and it was just over the top. Then, of course, on the Thursday, there was the big concert, and he blew the people apart. Everyone came out of the SCG going, oh, that was the best concert I've ever seen in my life. Get back to the hotel, well, it became like a circus back there. But that's, we'll tell you more about that during the special, but it's easy with all the hype that surrounds Michael Jackson to forget how it all began. At age 9, he was turning out million-dollar records when his friends were still in primary school. He has single-handedly rewritten recording history. He's redefined the term professional entertainer. And now he is here, Down Under. Since his arrival on Tuesday, we've seen amazing scenes. We've had hysterical fans, we've had a wedding, and last night, a security scare. We'll look at all those things later, and I'll tell you, this tour's got the lot. Michael's been on the road for 15 months. He chose Prague and the Czech Republic to launch history. And since then, he's made his way across Central Europe, North Africa, the Indian subcontinent, Southeast Asia, and New Zealand. The show billed as the biggest musical roller coaster of all time.
I mean, I don't often sit through, I have to be honest and own up, you know, the show from Woe to Go when we bring these shows out here, and I sat through, I was stuck to my seat the whole way. I thought it was just something else, just incredible. This guy, whatever you say about him, put all those things to one side. This guy's in a category on his own as a performer. I just thought it was sensational.
The show is designed to be a theatrical action. It's designed to offer what it's called, history. To go from one point to the next point and to bring the audience with it. It's designed to let them play with Michael and allow him to play with them.
Michael is no stranger to touring. He's been at it since the age of 6, when he and his brothers formed the Jackson 5. They had become the most successful recording group in history. In their 7 years at Motown, Michael and his brother sold nearly 100 million recordings. But in 1976, the Jacksons chose to move to CBS Epic Records. And the rest is history. Their next album, Destiny, went platinum. And with Can You Feel It, they entered a new era with music video sophistication never seen before. Ah yes, what a song. Now in every country the response for Michael is always the same, except that I think I'm going to have a nervous breakdown because this has all been too much for me. When we come back, I'll look at his arrival through the eyes of his fans. going on around here. There's people trying to get links to Sydney. There's people having nervous breakdowns here. I'm having a nervous breakdown. It's just quite crazy. And only one person, I'm sure, could ever cause this, and that's Michael Jackson. Well, without a doubt, he is the biggest recording star of all time. And his fans, yes, his fans, go to amazing lengths to try to meet him. Have a look at this. 1 p.m. Tuesday afternoon, and Michael leaves New Zealand on board a commercial aircraft bound for Australia. At about the same time, a dedicated group of his fans are assembling at a side gate at Sydney Airport, awaiting his arrival. As time ticks by, more of the media arrive, and with the appearance of several dozen security guards, it was apparent that Michael was not far away. And then for Michael, it was off to the hotel. And for the fans, a scramble into waiting taxis.
Where you going?
At the hotel, nearly 1,000 people waited for their turn to catch a glimpse.
It's like 8 o'clock or something. Searching all the rooms, harassing all the staff for his room number and everything.
His child expected early next year, and Debbie's going to be with him today, we think.
So we'll get to see
her. So we'll get to see the lady.
He loved it, every part of it. He was just, well, it showed. He was out there for 20 minutes with the fans, and he spent a lot of time before he actually got into his hotel suite. Now, he loved that. It was sort of the best arrival he's had.
People may say that Michael's security is a little over the top, but remember, he's been faced with screaming, uncontrollable fans since the early days of the Jackson 5. As a child, he was never able to go out and buy a burger or go shopping, so really, he's been a prisoner of his own popularity for nearly 30 years. In 1979, Don't Stop Till You Get Enough from the Off The Wall album was the first time Michael and his music producer Quincy Jones worked together. The results? Sales exceeding 8 million copies worldwide and Michael's first Grammy. I'll tell you what, that was one of my favourite songs. When I think about it now, you wouldn't believe, as I said before, the mayhem that's going on around here. I've almost had enough of this. All right, now listen, we're still trying to get our link up to the SCG. Now we're going to take a break, and when we come back, hopefully, we'll be crossing to the SCG. New wife, Debbie, along. Well, Michael arrived, but no wife and no wedding ring. Although the fans outside were content to catch a glimpse of Michael, the real show was happening inside the cinema as 900 guests were treated to an amazing display of Jackson wizardry.
You're right, I do like scared people. Yes.
He's a complete and utter legend.
Terrific. It was mind-blowing. Oh, the best special effects. It was just spectacular, right in your face. It was just amazing.
The real horror for Michael, though, began when he tried to leave. Hundreds of fans rushed forward, and he was ushered out by a tight circle of security guards. Absolute mania up there. And I tell you what, Ghosts, which Michael wrote with one of my favourite writers, Stephen King. It's quite incredible, and at one stage, I can't give it away, but at one stage you see the skeleton of Michael dancing, and it truly is something else. All right, now listen, I think we've got pictures backstage. Let's have a look. Well, there he is with Richard and his lovely wife, and hopefully we'll be able to connect up with the SCG after the break. Stay tuned. And the madness continues. Now, I tell you what, a few years ago, I had a lot of trouble keeping up with one of my mates getting married in Sydney, and that was Elton John to Renata, and I thought that was crazy. But on Thursday, as I said, on Thursday night when this wedding story broke, and then Friday morning when I had to fly back early in the morning, the media were going crazy. How anyone was able to follow this, I have no idea. But Tony Biocotti from the Today Show took over the story, and we go straight to Tony now. The wedding.
The girl is mine.
Until recently, Michael Jackson has been linked romantically and platonically with high-profile women, the glamorous and the famous. He adored film star Elizabeth Taylor, and the feelings seemed mutual.
I love you so much, Michael.
Jackson even gave her away at her eighth wedding, held at his ranch in 1991. Michael also seemed infatuated with Motown diva Diana Ross. In the 1980s, he was romantically linked to Brooke Shields.
Question. Did you have a crush on him, or did he have a crush on you?
I think we both had a crush, and still do have a crush on each other. I mean, I think...
At the 1991 Academy Awards, Michael's date was Madonna. In 1994, the King of Pop married the daughter of the King of Rock and Roll, Elvis's only child, Lisa Marie Presley.
Your love's got me high, I long to get by. This time is forever, love is the answer.
It was a marriage made in tabloid heaven. Many in the cynical American media believed the marriage was a ploy, a tactic to detract from the adverse publicity he'd received over claims he'd molested a 13-year-old boy.
I'm not going to marry somebody for any reason other than the fact that I fall in love with them, period.
And just think, nobody thought this would last.
It didn't last, though. No child for Jackson, and Lisa Marie told him to beat it and filed for divorce.
And it cuts like a knife. She's out of my life.
As we've seen on his Australian visit, Michael Jackson loves the company of children, possibly due to the fact that as a young star, he was never allowed a normal childhood of his own. He desperately wants his own child, and the world was astounded with reports his longtime friend, Debbie Rowe, was having his baby. Unlike other loves or friends, Debbie wasn't famous or glamorous. Debbie and Michael have been friends for 15 years. They met when she was an assistant to his Beverly Hills dermatologist. Her friends say Rowe loves Jackson in a brotherly way, and having his baby was a gift of love. Jackson denies that she was artificially inseminated or that she's being paid. In Sydney, after his first Australian concert, the shock news that he'd married Debbie in a very private ceremony at his hotel after midnight.
I was very sceptical, although you should never be sceptical when it comes to Michael Jackson.
But entertainment reporters like Peter Ford were at first wary, but Jackson's LA office confirmed the marriage. They didn't release many details, leaving room for rumour to run rife.
One story was he was married in the middle of the statue. He was in there for about an hour. I thought that was hilarious. The other one was in a church in King's Cross.
One of them was that he got married at 5 o'clock in the morning at the Wayside Chapel. Another was that he got married inside that huge statue, which is being floated on Sydney Harbour, sort of inside the statue, he and Debbie. Pretty bizarre, but often, you know, the truth is stranger than fiction, and certainly in the case of Michael Jackson, that's often the case.
Some fans were devastated by the news of the marriage.
I don't see the point of living anymore.
But most seem to take it well.
I'm happy for him. Yeah. If he's happy, I'm happy.
I was very jealous at first because I've always dreamed of marrying Michael, but I'm happy for them.
Me and my friends were sitting in the lobby last night and we had like no idea that Michael's getting married like 21 floors above us.
And the news of a baby Jackson?
He'd make the best father in the world. He should have millions of babies.
I think that's fabulous. I mean, we're going to have a little Michael Jackson in the world, so that should be interesting in about a decade's time.
The Australian tour was organised by promoter Paul Dainty. Despite being intimately involved in the tour planning, he says the marriage was a total surprise to him.
I didn't have any prior knowledge, no. I wasn't there. Look, I'm really happy for Michael. I think it's a fantastic thing for him to have done. Apparently he's really happy. That's all I can say.
And he denies those rumours that he was a guest and indeed best man.
Look, I've heard so many different stories, bizarre stories, since Michael landed here, and specifically related to the wedding. Molly and I were supposed to have gone to Michael's suite last night at 1 o'clock in the morning or something and seen the register and come back to the bar and continue drinking. You know, it's going to give me a completely different take on reading, believing what you read and, you know, what you perceive as the real story when you read these things coming in from overseas. I mean, these stories and tales get out of control.
The marriage announcement has attracted media attention from around the world. Press, radio and TV, usually hungry for news on Jackson, are now on a feeding frenzy, desperate to get those shots of the secret wedding and the new Mr. and Mrs. Jackson together.
Well, there it is, the wedding story, and we've got in the studios of Channel 9, Tony. Hi, welcome to the show, Tony.
Hi, Molly. What a crazy week it's been.
Oh, my God. As I said, I was there on Thursday afternoon and Thursday night for the concert, and the concert was fantastic, but to go back to that hotel, Sheraton on the Park, I will never forget that hotel again in my life, you know?
Now, what about those rumours that you were actually at the wedding?
I couldn't believe this. I mean, like, I got back to the hotel, and I was walking up the steps, and all these reporters came over and said, "Tell us about the wedding." I said, "What wedding?" They said, "Michael's getting married." I said, "He's getting married like this, you know?" Didn't know anything about that, went inside, and then came out, and I said, "Well, yes, apparently Debbie is here in the hotel, but I don't know anything about any wedding." And then finally I went to bed. I had some drinks with Paul Dainty, then went to bed, and then at 2 o'clock or 2:30, I had this call to my room from a journalist from one of the papers in Sydney saying, "Can you confirm the wedding and what was it like? And you were a guest there." I thought, well, either I've had too much to drink or I'm sleepwalking, for God's sake, you know? It was quite bizarre.
Yeah, now, have you actually seen the wedding certificate?
No, not yet. Have you?
I haven't as yet. What about him not wearing a wedding ring? Do we know that he's actually been married?
Well, yes, I mean, that's absolutely confirmed that he's married, and I believe that part of it. I mean, I think that's... And congratulations to both of them.
Yeah, now, it's almost been like a little whirlwind has swept into town, and we've all just been...
Whirlwind, I'd say it was like...
A tornado.
Hurricane Michael or whatever, you know?
Yeah, because I think everyone, the fans, the media covering it, we've all been just swept along into this.
I think there's a lot of tired people. I mean, I think the fans are fantastic, and they're willing to stay up all night. But I don't know if every camera crew and journo wants to stay up all night. They probably do when they're having a good time and having a party. But I tell you what, I've seen some very tired journos, including myself, over the last 3 days.
It's easy to tell the people who've been covering this. They've all got the dark circles under their eyes from lack of sleep.
They have indeed.
Now, do you get the feeling, though, that with Michael, the media is a bit of a plaything, that he calls the shots and we basically just have to follow?
Well, I think with any superstar, I mean, be it from Madonna and Prince, Elton John or whoever, or Lady Di or Princess Di, she's known, they certainly have that ability to do that. But I also think the media get themselves caught up in a bit of a frenzy as well and just, I mean, go for it, you know? And, I mean, it's crazy. I mean, you see people jumping over each other, photographers jumping over each other. I don't know how you cope with it all the time.
It's been pretty hard, and actually what's been most hard about it is that Michael has such a bizarre past and history that even the most outlandish rumours could actually be true. So sometimes you have to look at them as though they are a possibility.
Absolutely, but you've got to admit, I mean, like, I don't know if you've been to the concert, but... And the concert's on again tonight, but it's an amazing concert, it truly is, and he truly is a great performer, no matter what, you know?
Now, do you think it's great that we have characters like him, who I guess aren't your ordinary run-of-the-mill type person?
I think that basically any performer, I mean, be it Madonna or Prince, I mean, Prince, you don't call him by any name now. In fact, he said there's no vocal sound to his name, and I accidentally called him Lovey. I mean, it just gets a bit over the top. Listen, thanks for joining us. We've got to go, because
Thank
hopefully
you.
We'll link up, and... get some sleep, for God's sake.
I'll try to.
All right, we'll be back in a moment with the Michael Jackson as the story keeps going on and on and on. Michael Jackson. All right, well, welcome back. I tell you what, it is chaos up there in Sydney. They apparently lost power backstage, and Michael's had to go off on stage now. So the interview at this moment is off. Who will ever be able to speak to him? But we'll keep you tuned on that one, because he will be doing an interview, but we're not sure when now. But outside, where the power is still on, thank God, we have a man I admire a lot as our rock historian, and he is the guru, really, Glenn A. Baker. Glenn, how are you?
Molly, I'm fine, except this is a moment of much mayhem. This is a concert that absolutely challenges your point of gravity. The incredible pure kinetic energy of this thing has this place absolutely electrified, I've got to tell you.
Well, now, listen, I tell you what, you saw him only just recently. I saw him in Bangkok a couple of weeks ago, and that concert was just amazing, and then at the NCG the other night. You saw him in Spain, right?
That's right. I saw him in Zaragoza, Spain, in a bullring with about 50,000 people, and it was just like an electronic tableau. See, I suppose, given that Michael has this wonderful fascination for theme parks and this grasp of technology, Yeah, the show reflects that. The show, from the moment he arrives on stage in like a video delivery shoot, you might say, and bursts through the floor of the stage in a spaceship and steps out, the people are on their feet. There were adults around me with tears rolling down their faces, and he'd only done about the first few bars of Scream. I mean, he has an amazing effect on an audience, that's for sure.
He sure does. Now, what is the feeling there at the moment? I mean, I can hear all this noise and, it's just crazy.
I'm having a bit of trouble hearing you, so you might have to bear with me.
I'm just saying, I mean, the noise there is amazing that I can hear in the background. I mean, what is the feeling at the SCG tonight?
Yeah, the feeling, like I said, it is absolutely electrifying, because I think that people are expecting and are receiving a high-tech, super thrill show, one that actually stretches the edge of the envelope. And the one thing about Michael Jackson is that, the central fact of it all is he is an astonishing performer. And what I find interesting is, even though, I mean, when you actually hear him speaking, he has that, it's like a high, almost shrill voice. Performing, he's got a rich, full, strong voice. And in fact, the power of it is amazing. Yet to come, and I hope I'm not blowing it for people who haven't seen the show yet, but yet to come are things like, a military tank on stage. Yet to come are amazing pyrotechnics. Sort of a wall that gets built on stage. It's one of those things where you actually don't know where to look. In the beginning, you almost want to actually put on a seatbelt, because it's going to be like a skittering roller coaster.
Glenn, you sound so excited there. I mean, you haven't taken a breath in about 2 minutes. Quite amazing. Well, I tell you what, listen, let's have a look at what makes up this concert, because it is quite amazing. Jets coming in, semis. So let's have a look at that, of what's behind you, of how they put it all together. Thanks, Glenn.
Okay, Molly, take care, mate.
Okay, Bye. Let's go. The logistics for the concert are huge. The Stage for History has taken over 2 weeks to construct, and on Tuesday, 3 of the world's largest freight planes arrived into Sydney carrying 280 tonnes of equipment. 33 semi-trailers were there to ferry the gear to the SCG and are now sitting empty, waiting for the D-rig tomorrow. Over 150 local stagehands have worked alongside the Jackson crew to assemble this huge event.
At the moment, there's 4 stages being built so that we can keep up with what we're doing.
We've got a fantastic team of people. There's, 200-300 people involved in this tour, and every one of them are super professional. So, it's hard and it's full on, and it never stops until it's all over when he leaves the country. You get tired, not a lot of sleep for everyone, but, we'll make it, and everyone's on a high, everyone that's involved with the tour. I mean, they know they're involved with something very special.
Although each new work for Michael has been more successful than the last, nothing could have prepared him for what happened with the Thriller album. Thriller was released in 1983 and was just one of the Thriller's string of hits.
Michael Jackson.
Beat it!
song of the year is We Are the World.
We're done and out, and there seems no hope at all.
But if you just believe,
Thriller won an incredible 58 platinum records in 28 countries on 6 continents, and in America, an incredible 8 Grammy Awards. The total sales of the album have exceeded 40 million copies, earning a place in the Guinness Book of World Records as the largest selling album of all time. Well, there it is, Thriller by Michael Jackson. Now, I tell you what, Michael is a very shy man and a man who's only been interviewed in recent times by only 3 people, one of them being me, for 60 Minutes. I've interviewed him twice, and it was going to be a third time tonight, but we'll keep you posted on that one and when we're going to do that interview. But let's have a look at Michael way back in 1987 when I caught up with Michael for 60 Minutes in Tokyo, Japan.
Most of my dreams seem to come true, and I'm so thankful that they do. I don't know over what period of time, but I have lots of dreams and they usually come true, and I'm so glad. That's what's so wonderful about traveling. I get to see all the cultures and people and the children. It's wonderful. It's my greatest inspiration, I would say. It's hard to say how one creates music, because it's hard for me to take credit. I feel it's more spiritual and heavenly than I can't take credit for it.
If you're given one wish now, what would you like?
One wish?
Yeah. If I was going to say the fairy godmother, but I won't say that. If I could give you a wish, is there anything you wish for?
There's so many I have, but one of the main ones, would be as simple as making the whole world happy and world peace, and that is part of the reason why I do what I do.
I tell you what, that really actually makes me laugh when I look back at that interview, because you should never say things in jest, they say. And when I said, well, if I was a fairy godmother, which I'm not, or I won't ask that, unfortunately, I am now going to be the fairy godmother, and you could say, has he gone completely mad like Michael? Because in December, in Melbourne, we're doing Hey Hey at Cinderella, the pantomime, with Red and Willie and Blackers and everyone, and my role is the fairy godmother. And when you think tonight about this interview, there's another saying, always the bridesmaid, never a bride. We are going crazy. Next we cross back to the Sydney Cricket Ground and we have a chat with my mate, Richard Wilkins. He may be able to find some sanity in this, believe me. Now, what's happening out there at the moment?
Good evening, Molly. How's the show going?
Good, mate, good.
Just when you think you're having a busy old year, Michael Jackson comes to town and the whole world goes crazy.
Please.
It's been incredible. Molly, I was actually backstage with Michael just before he went on. Incidentally, this is a pretty good vantage point, isn't it, Michael, up there singing
Fantastic.
You Are Not Alone? Yeah, I was backstage there. He was having a couple of photos taken with some fans who were lucky enough to get close, and he was getting set to answer the questions for this special. But unfortunately, they did have an audio problem, and sadly, Michael hasn't been able to participate face-to-face in this special tonight, but I have it on good authority out of the man's mouth himself. That fella up on stage has said that he's going to talk to you probably next week, certainly before he leaves Australia. So rest easy, Molly, my friend.
Now tell me, Richard, what do you take if you're going to have a nervous breakdown? Seriously.
I think you just lay back and you put on a Michael Jackson record. It's been an incredible week, hasn't it?
Now, listen, I saw you with your family and your lovely wife.
Yeah.
I mean, how do you and them rate the concert? I mean, is it... I mean...
Well, I was casting my mind back, Molly, as you would well remember, when you and I were in Munich at the Olympic Dome there when we saw the first concert of Michael's Dangerous Tour.
Hey!
And
that was your fiancée then, not your wife.
That's very
Absolutely.
True. You have got a good memory.
Thank
but,
God.
You know, you and I and people like Glenn A have seen a few shows in our time, but yet this guy here can still send the electricity running through your body. He is the consummate showman. And when you read and see and hear so much about Michael Jackson and you see him on stage, you realize that he lives for this moment. He lives for this 2 hours every couple of nights when he walks on stage, and his whole life is geared around that. I read your excellent piece in the newspaper today, and you know what you said is true. Michael is on stage the moment he gets out of bed. You know, he's performing. His whole life is based around performance, but this is the ultimate for him, certainly, when he's on stage singing and pouring his heart into some songs, and it's just fantastic to see.
Well, I tell you what, it's really strange. I mean, like with the live show, as we saw with Madonna when she came out here and performed, and she did a lot from the Erotica album, I thought some of the numbers live on stage had a better edge and were a better performance than on the record.
Yeah.
I must say, the performance of Michael in this concert of his current single, Stranger in Moscow, is just breathtaking. It sends tingles down your spine.
Yeah, well, Madonna's concert was terrific. She reinterpreted a lot of songs for the live show, but Michael, you know, this is a greatest hits tour. Michael knows what the fans want. Mm. They want to hear the new stuff. They want to hear the old stuff. And this is just, I don't know, can you hear this? Why don't I stop talking and put the microphone off? Have a listen to this. Pretty good, huh?
Absolutely, mate. Listen, we've got to go. Thank you very much for your time, Richard.
Hey, it's a pleasure,
and
mate.
Give a kiss to your lovely wife.
Yeah, I will.
Because I can't, because I've got that damn cold, right? All right.
And if we catch up with Michael after the show, we'll tell him you're looking for him.
All right, and just tell him you can send me down a bottle of Valium, because I tell you what, I'll need it after this.
I'll put it on your tab, mate. I think it's still running.
All right, mate. Thank you.
See you,
Molly. Listen, it's now time to say goodnight. Sorry about the interview. We'll hopefully get that interview over the next couple of weeks. And if we do, we'll show it on Hey Hey or whatever. But it's good night from me. It's good night, and thanks to all the team up there. And let's go out with the number that truly is a great number and superb on stage. It's called Stranger in Moscow, Mr. Michael Jackson.